you give your tithes and your offerings, that God will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room to contain?
Amen.
Do you believe if you give your tithes and offerings that God will bless you good measure, pressed down, shake it together, and run it over?
Amen.
But if you are a believer and you believe it, like, let's participate in our tithes and offerings and believe God for return on what we do tonight, in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for this opportunity given to your kingdom. We want to thank you, Lord, that you're true to your word, and we count on it, and we lean on it. In Jesus' name, we give you praise for it, sir. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. Amen.
Praise God.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. I've heard the tender whisper of love in the Johnson tonight. Praise God.
Well, thank you so much. Always good to see you. Glad you could be here this evening. Summertime is here, right? It is really heated up. I mean, I've been working outside a little bit. Praise God. I know Brother Wayne yesterday spent 6 hours on that ditch out there with one of the commercial weed eaters. You try that one time, see? That's a tough one. But he did it. And he does it regular, too. But we thank God for all of you, and we thank God for what you do and your participation here at church. And Sister Collins gave me a good report on Brother Jimmy. And so he's doing well. We thank God for that. Brother Archie today told me that Faye walked 129 feet. Amen. Possibly she, isn't that good? And possibly she may even come home maybe Friday. But we'll see how that goes. But I do know this, she's getting closer every day.
Amen.
Every day. Well, we've been talking about being a finisher, and let's continue that tonight. Now, for the last 2 weeks, we talked about a need for perception, and we covered that. And then we also said that trials and difficulties are a part of running our race and finishing our course. Paul said in Acts 20:24, Paul said, I don't count my life dear to myself. Why? Because he wanted to be a finisher. Finish what God had given him to do. We know that Paul finished what God had given him to do because he said in 2 Timothy 4:7, I have fought a good fight. I have kept the faith. Now look at John chapter 4, the Gospel of John chapter 4. And we want to read what John said. Chapter 4, and let's look at verse 34. Jesus said unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to what? And to finish his work. He's saying that my food, my motivation, my nourishment is to do the will of my Father. It's my pleasure to do them, to accomplish what he sent me to do, and to finish it. Now look at John 17. John chapter 17. And we want to look at verse 4. Jesus said, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have what? I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. So he's saying that God gave me a work to do. He gave me an assignment, and I have finished it. So it's not only important that we start and run this race, but we finish. I want to be a finisher, don't you?
Yes.
And if you're a finisher, you're not a loser. Right? Then Jesus said in John 19:30, this was when he was on the cross, he said, it is finished. Now let's look at Hebrews for just a moment. Hebrews chapter 4. And we want to look at verse 3. For we which have believed do enter into rest. As he saith, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. God is saying, my work, my intent, my plan were finished from the foundation of the world. God said, I had a plan. And that plan was hidden in Jesus Christ. Paul called it the mystery, and he had a revelation of it, of what God did for us, what Christ did for us. And he saw it already finished. He saw it complete. So our job is to simply get in line with the assignment that he's already given us and cooperate with him that we see that we can finish our race and our course. So we're talking about being a finisher. Tell your neighbor, I'm a finisher.
I'm a finisher.
So God wants us to finish. God gave us his plan, and God expects us to finish. God gave the Apostle Paul a plan from his birth. He gave Jeremiah a plan from his birth. He gave John the Baptist a plan from his birth. But some of us don't tap into it until later on in life. But the Bible does say that the steps of a good man are ordered by God. Amen. The Bible tells us that he has preordained some things that we should walk in. And we perceive that through prayer, through meditating on the Word of God, worshiping God. We perceive certain direction and mandate that God has given to us, and he wants us to finish. Everybody has an assignment. Yeah. It's an assignment, but we have to finish it. Will we finish it? Say, I will finish it. See, God expects us not to get started and then stop. Now, it's more important to finish a job than it is to start a job and then don't finish it. When you finish a job, it gives you self-confidence. It gives you a sense of accomplishment, right? Amen. And I tell you something else it'll do. It will defeat the mind, because along the way your mind will tell you, you can't do it. You can't make it. It's too hard. But when you finish, you realize that you can bring your mind under control. You can bring your flesh under control. Because the mind and the flesh wants to give in a lot of times because there's pressure. And so we'll come up short. But God wants us to be finishers. So it's more important to finish something than it is to start it. Jesus was a finisher. And we are to follow his example regardless of how difficult things may come. Number two, principles of being a finisher. You have to always examine what's growing in you. Because the environment has great power to influence, to motivate your life. That's always easy. And it's not always easy to get some of the things that we've had in our life, to get it out of us. Did you know that? But you have to examine it. You have to examine it and see what is growing in you. Some people grow up in the ghetto, and they never get the ghetto out of them. Amen. It still influences them to this day. It influences how they think, how they relate to people, how they're aware of all of this stuff around them. And so you have to take an inventory and look and be honest and say, what's growing up in me? You got to be a finisher. Dr. Ben Carson, world-renowned brain surgeon, children brain surgeon, grew up in the ghetto, but he didn't let the ghetto get in him. Amen. He was determined to learn and to grow and develop. And so we got to be determined. We want to grow and we want to develop. Some things you just got to uproot in you. Some things need to be uprooted. Because you got control of your destiny, control of your upbringing and your future. It's hard sometimes to get that stuff out of you. That's the reason someone pushes your button sometimes and the wrong kind of words start coming out of your mouth. Everybody keep smiling now. Isn't that true? Now, we have to be honest with ourselves and say, God, I got to change this. I don't want this stuff growing up in me. I want to be a finisher. I don't want it to hinder me. I don't want it to cause me to stop short. And some of this stuff we need to get out of. I mean, where I grew up, the environment I grew up in, I mean, I look back on my Christian life. I didn't get it all out at one time, and I'm sure there's some stuff still there. But you know what? I got some of it out. Because I was determined to change. I knew I couldn't keep behaving and acting the way I was acting and talking the way I was talking. And even though you're a Christian, it'll spill over. And that environment, what's growing up in you, will come back to surface if you don't do something about it. If you don't renew your mind with the Word of God and you don't take control over your flesh, it'll spring right back up. And number three, don't ever be caught sitting down in a place of defeat. Defeat is not an option. dead end and obstacles and barriers are part of this real world that we live in. And you're going to have barriers and obstacles you're going to face in this life. But you got to kick them down. And God will give you wisdom how you can get through it, you can get around it, you can get over it, but refuse to be caught sitting down in a spirit of defeat and failure and discouragement. Because we are more than conquerors.
Amen.
If God be for us, who can be against us? The Lord is on our side. Amen. God can open up doors that no man can open. Allow your spirit man to control you, not your mental and your physical part. If you don't have a purpose, your emotional realm will control you. Because when the soulish man, sometimes he wants to quit. And he'll get tired. And he'll feel like crying the blues and giving in and giving up. And when you feel like you can't make it, reach down and pull your boots up. Just pull your bootstraps up. Yeah. Say, I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, I will not give up. Because we're finishers. One of the four lepers said, why sit we here till we die? Why are you accepting defeat? Why are you going to sit around and cry the blues and say, I just can't do it. It's just too hard. But when they got up, God got up. The man at the pool of Bethesda, when he got up, he had to get up on the inside before he got up on the outside. I know you heard the story. I probably told it several times, but the little boy sitting in church, he wouldn't be still. His mother kept pushing him down, wouldn't sit down, kept pushing him down. And finally, she just, you know, got a little bit tired of it. And so his dad was sitting there, and he picked him up, threw him over his shoulder, and he looking back at the congregation that the dad went out. He said, I may be sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside. That's what you got to do. When it looks like you're going to get knocked down, you can't make it. You got to determine, I will make it. Don't ever accept defeat. I was told many years ago when we started this ministry, you can't build a church in that. You can't build a church. And that's the phrase, you can't build a church like that in Nashville. I don't know what they meant, like that. I reckon a Holy Ghost church, a word church, a faith church. You know, we started out that way, and hopefully we've grown in all of those areas. But we're still the same.
Yeah.
We preach the same message.
Yeah.
We don't change. It was right for then, and it's right for now. It worked then, and it'll work now. It was good for us then, and it's good for us now. Can somebody give God a praise?
Yeah.
Don't ever wallow in defeat. I was told you can't build a church. You can't build that outreach center. I remember talking about this facility right over here. I remember when we reached a place, the only thing we could do was lay a slab of cement for this room you're in right now. No wall, no nothing of it. And we didn't have any more money. We ran out of money. We didn't have any more money. And it lay there for a long enough time, people would ride by and say, they're never going to build that church. I didn't think they were. It's just laying. It'll never be nothing. But I said, you just keep looking. You just keep your eyes open. And after a while, the walls went up. And all of this facility that we have, it came into place. And thank God it's paid for.
Amen.
They said we couldn't do it, but I didn't accept defeat. They said we couldn't build that facility. We got over there on Highway 58, millions of dollars. They said, you can't do that. You don't have the resources. You don't have the people. You don't have the money. I said, well, God told us to do it. I have an assignment. See, I came here with an assignment. And I would not give up. Now, I had plenty of opportunities to give up. Have you ever had any opportunity to give up? And I'm telling you, your flesh and mind sometimes, it wants to. But we do not accept defeat. Laverne Tripp used to sing a song, I will not be defeated. How many of you determined you will not be defeated? But praise God, we got to do what God has called us to do. All things are possible to him that believeth. See, there's always dead end. There's always obstacles. But we can run through a troop and we can leap over a wall. 1,000 shall fall at thy side and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it won't come nigh thee. If you have the mindset of a finisher. David slayed Goliath. And Caleb himself slayed some giants. Caleb said, give me this mountain when he was 85. When they were passing out the inheritance and distributing the land, somebody said, give me this little piece of land over here by this nice brook. Or this is a shady green place over here. Give me this place. Caleb said, I don't want that. That's for sissy britches. He said, give me this mountain. And he climbed that mountain. And when he got there, what did he find? Giants there. But you know what he did? He threw them off of the mountain, built a memorial unto God, and lifted his hand and started singing, I'm living on the mountain underneath God's clear blue skies. I'm drinking from the fountain that never shall run dry. I'm living on the mountaintop.
Amen.
85 years old, and he was a winner. Amen. Say, I'm a winner. Say, I'm a finisher. Number four, resolve to overcome fear. Did you know fear will paralyze you? Fear will cause you to make wrong decisions. Fear will keep you from being a finisher. There's 365 fear nots in the Bible. 365. See, we have to fight fear. You have to know that God is on your side. You have to know that you're in the world, but you're not of the world, and we're world overcomers. He said, don't be afraid. Now look at Isaiah chapter 41. How many of you determined you're not going to be afraid? Because fear will absolutely paralyze you. It'll freeze you. It'll keep you from advancing if you're full of fear. But John Osteen, he wrote a book, Demonstrating Satan's Defeat. In other words, the devil's not going to leave until you demonstrate that you have authority. You have to use your authority. Did you know that? He's not going to back off until you show him who you are. I can remember, I used to be afraid of flying. I didn't want to get on an airplane. I didn't. Because I had this idea. Way back there, see, this was something instilled in me in my society and growing up. Religion did this. Even though I didn't go to church, I heard religious people talking about that. They said, you know, if you get on that plane and God decides to pull your number, pull that pilot's number. He ain't got nowhere to land it. And so I thought, you get on a plane, what if God takes that pilot life? We know that God don't do that, but I'm telling you, that's the kind of stuff I heard. So I was afraid to get on there. Because I thought God might be ticked off with me the way I was living anyway. You know what I mean? And I thought, what if I get up there and God pulls that pilot's number, comes up. But see, I didn't realize, I didn't even think like this. Look, God don't have to wait until you get in a plane and fly. Because if he wanted to, he could have a plane flying 35,000 feet up, come over your house and start dropping and hit right into your house and that be it. But God doesn't do that. But it taught me to be afraid and taught me to be afraid of God. And I was afraid to fly. And I knew the only way I'd ever get over is go buy me a ticket and fly. Fly to friendly skies. And it's beautiful when you get up there on a clear day. Now, I have been up there with some turbulence, knocking that plane around. But I tell everybody, I said, don't worry about it. I'm on board. This plane's not going down. You got to believe you got authority. Isn't that right? So there's 365 fear nots in the Bible. But you got to demonstrate Satan's defeat. When you get up every day, use one of those 365. When you get up on Monday, use one of those fear not. You get up on Tuesday, use one of those fear not. You get up on Wednesday, use one of those fear not. Do what you got to do today without fear. Talk to whoever you got to talk to without fear. The Bible said the fear of man brings a snare. Not man, but just the fear of it. But you got to do what you got to do. And do not be afraid. You got to deal with it. Don't fear man. God is on your side. You got the power of God and the anointing of God. God is with you. And you got to be a finisher and demonstrate it. Now look at Isaiah chapter 41:10. Say, I'm a finisher. He said, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will what? Yes, I will what? And I will what? With my righteous right hand. Now shout about that, somebody.
Hallelujah.
Now look at verse 11. Behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing. And they that strive with thee shall perish. Thou shalt seek them and shall not find them. Even them that contended with thee, they that war against thee shall be as nothing, as a thing of naught. Zero. Isn't that good? For I am the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. Every time you get in a hard situation, you just start to lift your hand and say, God is my helper.
Yes.
Say that. Say, God is helping me. God is strengthening me. God is with us. He said, I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. I hear people say, I'm so lonely. I'm so lonely. I'm lonely. Well, wait a minute. I know loneliness can be real. But when the enemy tries to get you discouraged about being lonely and that kind of thing, you just look at him and say, I'm not by myself.
Amen.
The Lord is with me.
Yes.
He'll never leave me. He'll never forsake me. Isn't that good news? Praise God. He said, I'll uphold thee. And realize that these barriers that are thrown up against you, they're just stumbling blocks to try to get you to accept defeat. The devil's always throwing something in your path. I mean, you think about it. Just about every time you start something important, it don't always go as smooth as you want to through the whole process, does it?
Nope.
It doesn't. It don't always work out like we want it to. But if you'll stay with it and be determined, somehow things just work out, don't they?
Amen.
But they never work out for quitters. Do not find yourself in a seat of defeat, crying the blues and just feeling sorry for yourself. You know, a lot of people feel sorry for themselves. Did you know the devil wants you to feel sorry for yourself?
Yes.
Woe is me. And when you get to doing that, you think you're the only one that ever been through anything. Everybody goes through something. Isn't that right?
Yes.
But you got to be a finisher. Because statistically, you cannot get a corn out of a fish's mouth. But that's exactly what Jesus told Peter to do. He said, you go fishing, and the first fish you catch, you take the corn out of his mouth, and you pay my taxes and your taxes. impossibilities. It looks impossible for a whale to swallow a man, but a whale swallowed Jonah. Heard on the news the other day, I don't know how true this was, but about a whale swallowed a man. But if God said a whale swallowed Jonah, then you know what? A whale swallowed Jonah. But there's impossibilities that you're going to face. But God is a God of impossibilities. And when you start winning and you have victories, let me tell you, or you, even when you start sharing some of the things you're going through, be careful who you share it with. Be sure who you tell your victories to. Be careful. It can either help you or hurt you. Because somebody tell you, well, I know somebody that tried that. It didn't work. Oh, I know what you're saying, but you better rethink this thing. Listen to this. Sometimes the greatest barriers in our life are other people. So be careful who you share it with. I mean, you think about Joseph. He had these big dreams. God gave him dreams, and he had these big dreams. And he thought he'd share it with his brothers. He told them, I saw you bowing down to me. I saw your sheaves bowing down to me. They weren't glad for him that he was being blessed and going to be exalted, but they got jealous. What they did, threw him in a pit. Sold him into slavery. Ended up in Potiphar's house, and his wife lied on him. He was thrown in prison, and he was there for many, many years. But God exalted him, got him out of that prison, got him out of that trouble, and he became succored in command to Egypt. So we need to be careful who we share our dreams with, because not everybody wants to see you succeed. I ought to get a better witness than that. I mean, they didn't want Jesus to succeed. I mean, they tried to kill him one time. Stone him, kill him. Jesus was in a crowd one day, and they were going to stone him. They were going to push him off the cliff. He just walked right through. So be careful who you share your dreams with. So don't let people be a reason why you stop. When something's in your spirit that you know is from God, it takes precedent over anything else. I know, because God gave me an assignment. At first, I didn't want to do it. I was perfectly happy right where I was, making good money, had a good job, had a good life, and a good wife. And still, I'm doing what I want to do, and still got a good wife. Now, Lois was my first wife, but the only wife. God has been good. And I'm telling you, I've had many obstacles laid in front of me. I've had many barriers to try to stop me. I've seen times it would have been easy to say, I quit. I don't have to do this. I don't have to put up with this. But I have an assignment. And I'm telling you, each and every one of you right in here tonight, you've got an assignment. You got an assignment in ministry too. It may be in the ministries of helps, whatever it may be. But you have an assignment. And God wants us to complete it. Let's stand at our feet. I mean, even in the ministry. You think if people really going to be, if anybody's going to be for you, it would be people of the cloth. I've had them to tell me, oh, you shouldn't be doing that. You don't need to do that. But I had it in my spirit. And what God put in my spirit takes precedent over anything else anybody says. Any facts, any kind of information, it takes precedent over anything. And you know, I can look back on my life. And by the way, I am not finished. Amen. can look back on my life and I can honestly say from my heart, God sure has been good to me. If God's been good to you, lift your hands and praise Him. Just praise Him for being here.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes, and I'm quitting, sometimes you just got to walk away from people.
Amen.
Because they can discourage you. I mean, David came down to his brothers. They were fighting the war. He's out tending sheep, you know. So his dad sent him down there, carry some crackers and cheese to his brother. And he got down there, and they heard about Goliath, and he heard Goliath come out cursing his God and all that. And they were cowering, Saul and his army, they were cowering in doubt and unbelief, and they were afraid, and they were hiding. And David said, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Is there not a cause?" His brother said, "Shut up, you're being naughty." David went out and faced Goliath. And when he faced his giant, God gave him a great victory. When you face your giants in life, just know victory is on its way.
Yeah.
Let's lift our hands again and praise God. Come on. Come on. Say this: what God has put in my heart, I will finish it. My assignment is to finish. Because you're my helper. You strengthen me. I'm getting up tonight. I'm going over to the other side because I'm a finisher. Now let's thank God for the word tonight. Let's thank Him for the word tonight. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And if you're discouraged tonight, get up on the inside of you.
Hallelujah.
One of the great ways to get up is just start praising God right where you are. I dare you, D-double dog you, to give God some fanatical, radical kind of praise right now.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Encouragement out of the word tonight.
Amen.
Determined to be a finisher.
Yeah.
One last thing. I got too many miles to turn back now.
Amen.
You think about it.
Yeah.
I look at all of them. We've come too far to turn back now.
Amen.
I'm talking about too far with God. I don't have anything to turn back to, do you? I don't have anything I want to turn back to. Let's be finishers.
Yes.
And let's be examples to others.
Yes.
That what God has started in us, He will complete it until that day.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Thank you for coming tonight. See you Sunday morning over on Highway 58. Okay?
Yes.